of the chain, right? So, but it was raining hard that night. I didn't even think they were going to have it because it had poured all day and it was pouring. So I deliberately sat in the stands and didn't even try to get down on the floor. And so it stopped raining, and about the time it started, but then about Michael W. Smith's third and first song, it started sprinkling. And I was just thinking, you know, there's people here, there's Episcopalians in here, there's Methodists in here, there's Baptists in here. So I imagine when it started sprinkling, the Episcopalians were happy because a lot of them got sprinkled that day. And then it started raining, started pouring. And then I was figuring the Methodists were probably pretty happy because a lot of people got poured on that day. But then it just started coming down like cats and dogs. And I was happy because a lot of people got baptized that night down in the middle of that stadium. Anyway. Okay. I thought y'all would think that was funny. We've been in Ephesians chapter 3, the first 13 verses for 4 weeks. And I'm going to finish up here this morning. So we've talked about, Paul's talked about, we've just kind of applied it to our lives, valuing the treasure that we have in Christ. Then we talked about a grace that serves, okay? And then last week we talked about living out unity. And I really hope if you missed that, you'll go back and try to watch that on YouTube. And then what I want to talk to you about today is living with confidence. We just sang a lot about living with confidence. And I know all of you were singing. I could hear you. And really, I think the music, I could tell, was kind of moving y'all this morning. So the words of the music was lifting you towards this, living in confidence, a knowing, a hope, whatever you want to call it. Confía and trust, right? Let me read 7 through 13, and I want to concentrate today on 11, 12, and 13 in chapter 3. Paul's saying, of this gospel, he was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given to him by the working of his power to me, to Paul, though he's the very least of all the saints. This grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches in Christ and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for the ages in God who created all things, so that through the church the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. And concentrate here. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with what? Confidence through our faith in him. The him is Jesus, okay? So I ask you not to lose heart over what I'm suffering for you, which is your glory. Linking suffering to glory there. Okay? Well, even that kind of came up even in our prayers this morning with the worship team. When we talk about our suffering, Paul would strongly feel that that suffering is part of our demonstrating our living out that which Christ did for us on the cross. So I've been thinking a lot about this, though, the last few weeks. And I always do, because, you know, life can be difficult. No doubt about it. I know sometimes, as Christians, some Christians try to make us feel bad about ourselves if we're finding life difficult or having trouble. But I see this here in this passage. Paul's suffering. and he's suffering, and life can be difficult, and because we're in the world, we have suffering all around us. I mean, don't you sometimes wish you had the answers for all the suffering that's going on? I wish I did. I wish I could take it all away. And there's evil around us. We see and witness evil, and there's death all around us. I just spoke about Billy Graham, and death catches up to every one of us, if not ourselves, catches up to our loved ones, and then eventually it's going to catch up to us. So around us is evil, and there's suffering, and there's death. And I kind of hit on this with my Christmas message when I spoke on discouragement, because I wanted to speak to discouragement this year at Christmas. But discouragement and a sense of, you know, some people might feel beaten up, some people might feel beaten down, but either way, sometimes we have this sense of being discouraged, and that, like, the world is just beating us up. I know many of you told me, and I know, but we kind of all go through this. We all have a point in our life sometimes when we say, stop it. I've had enough. The world's just beating up on me so much. I need a break from it. It just seems like it keeps coming. And so sometimes that makes us feel discouraged. We have this sense that we're beat up. And if we don't fall into a denial, even talking as a Christian, if we don't fall into a denial, sometimes a Christian can get real pessimistic. You're thinking, I've never met one. I've never met a pessimistic Christian, right? We don't have any in our house, right? Or the other thing that can happen is people will withdraw. We all have family members, friends, even in the church. They just get so beat up on that they pull completely away. They withdraw. Okay? That's the usual result. That's the common result when these things come. But Paul's suggesting here that among suffering, that we're to live with confidence. Okay? And that's what I pick up on the end of this passage. Living in confidence. So here's the question that comes to me. That begs to be asked of this passage, of us Christian. Is it possible to be realistic about the world we live in, but live confidently? Is it possible? You remember last week, and I won't go into it again and re-preach it, but I'd really like you to go back, because I think part of the struggle we have is we have this idea of what's ideal and what's real. And we can't have the idea, life, marriage, whatever, so we just settle for what's real. And then we say, well, I'm just being real, Pastor. This is what's real. And so sometimes it gets for Christians where pain and suffering and death are just what's real. Okay? And I told you last week, no, we're not idealists. We're not. Paul wasn't idealistic. What was real for Paul was the ideal life, the ideal marriage, the ideal church, whatever it was. Okay? So, too often, though, Christians, they learn about confidence in Jesus, and what they do, they say, oh, this is just, I don't know if I can do this, though, but I hear about this confidence that I'm supposed to have in the name of Jesus. So, they think, well, I call it like a spirituality of confidence. Just people trying to convince themselves that they're confident in Jesus. And I've spoken this before. It's the person, and you can see this in church sometimes, it's the, you know, turn the music up louder, make the coffee stronger, and smile bigger, and then I'll appear to be more confident in Jesus. Now, I like good music, and I like good coffee, and people who smile. But sometimes, people are smiling, but there's no confidence in their life, right? And so, that's kind of denial. It's kind of a denial, if you will. You, I mean, how many of you have just denied your problems and they all went away? I'm just going to deny it and they'll go away. I mean, sometimes I do try that. I am not going to be sick today. I am not going to be sick today. I have too much to do. And then a couple hours later, you end up on your back or something, you know. You can take that to all kinds of extremes. But Paul knew how hard it was to be a Christian. Just read the New Testament. The stonings, the floggings, all of those things, the beatings, the shipwrecks, the storms that he went through. He knew. He's not talking to you and me as a guy who had it easy. He knew how hard it was to be a Christian. And he was still confident. Okay? He looked into difficulty. If difficulty had a face, he looked at it in the face and he stared it straight in the eyes. Okay? He went into difficulties with his eyes wide open, so to speak. But those difficulties weren't what was ultimate, what was real to him. Prison wasn't a reality for him. You say, well, it should have been. He was sitting in prison, but that's not what was real to Paul. Prison wasn't real to Paul. And the New Testament is full of Paul's trials and full of Paul's struggles. But no matter what the circumstances were, prison, beating, hunger, shipwreck wasn't real for Paul. What was real for Paul? It's the easy Sunday school answer. Life in Jesus was what's real for Paul. My life in Christ, who I am in Jesus, who Jesus says I am, who God sees me as, is the reality. Okay, that should determine each day for Paul who he was. And so what did this bring for him? I feel it when I read what this will do for us. It brings a settledness for us. And that's what we need. We need a settledness about us. That's how we deal with difficulty. That's how we deal with suffering. That's how we deal with evil. That's how we deal with death. Okay? So I'll just sit here before you today and say, every one of us is going to suffer hardship. If you haven't yet, or you're not right now, get ready. Okay? It's life in this world. Hard. It's hard. We're going to suffer hardships. Now, some of them are even ones we have to take on because we're Christian. Because we take on the cross. When Jesus said, those who follow me are going to pick up their cross and carry it, follow me. He didn't literally mean you're going to pick up a wooden cross and carry it. It means it's going to be as though you're carrying a big, heavy wooden cross. So some of the things as a Christian, we accept and bring on ourselves, right? That's a fact. But a lot of things that we go through and we suffer, we didn't ask for them. We don't want them to come upon us. We didn't choose them. But that doesn't make them any easier to avoid. Right? Right? Sometimes I get upset when I hear people talk about people who are in a bad way, whatever it may be, and they say, well, that's the life they chose, so they're just going to have to suffer through it. Nobody chooses a hard life. Nobody chooses hardship. No. Do we make bad decisions? Yeah. Stand up, whoever has never made one. We're going to give you the prize today. We've all made mistakes, right? But here's the thing. When we go through hardships as Christians, we don't go through it alone, right? We're not alone. We are never alone, okay? And discouragement's going to come. It can come. But here's the thing, it's not going to find a home in us. And that's what we're not to do, not to let discouragement settle in and find a place, a home with us. Because Christians, according to Paul and according to the New Testament, we have access to God. We are at home with God. When we are not where we are to be is when we're not with God, we're not with Christ, we're not in fellowship with Him. When we're in fellowship with Christ, then we're at home. That's when things feel normal. Have you ever been away from home and you just couldn't wait to get back there? You've just been in a strange place It's just not comfortable, is it? And we just sang about that. We just sang a great song about that. I'm coming back. Well, you know, in a sense, I'll tell you, you can't ever leave God, but it can feel like it. But it's not Him that moved. It's us. It's us that moved. So we enjoy this access to God, and we're at home. As Paul would say, we're in, by, and with Him all the time. It's in God that we find our meaning. Okay? And I know a lot of us have had accomplishments, and we maybe identify with those, but that's not who you really are. And a lot of us have had the opposite of that. We've been discouraged. We've not accomplished maybe some of the things we wanted to be who we are. But that's the failure is not who we are either. We are who we are in Jesus. We do everything we do in, by, and through Jesus. And we're at home enough with Him that it makes us confident. Okay? That's how the confidence comes. You know, when I got married, or when I started dating my wife, this is one of the coolest things about her mom. Just immediately, she would say, "This is your home. Everything here is yours." And I took that literally. So I just started coming over every day. And I started eating dinner there every day. And anything that was in the refrigerator, I considered mine. So I just would come over and just act like it was mine. My mom wondered where I went. I think, oh, I know. But you know, I felt at home in her house, just as if I were home. Well, that's a little of the way it is with Jesus, but all the earthly things kind of fall apart when you're trying to compare it. But what happens is, when we're not a Christian, we feel at home in the world. And the things of the world make us feel good, whatever they may be, whatever that may be for you. The world makes you feel good. And being around other Christians who are in Christ, that makes you feel uncomfortable. They're living in a place that you don't like, that doesn't feel good. So when we come to know Jesus and we're living in Christ, then the old doesn't feel good anymore. And when we're in our relationship with Him, we begin to feel good and feel confident. It's like I felt confident just walking into their home and eating their food and sleeping wherever I wanted to. It was like it was mine. When we get into this relationship with Jesus, we can't stand not being in relationship with Jesus. So it gives you such a confidence and awareness of God in His gospel then begins to make us optimistic. Okay? Would you rather be around an optimist or a pessimist? I guess if you're a bunch of pessimists, it doesn't bother you as bad. Right? Everybody complaining and being pessimistic. But if you're an optimist, it'll drive you crazy being around pessimists. It'll just drive you. It's like people scratching on a chalkboard. You're like, come on, it's not that bad, is it? It can't be that bad. There's got to be something happening in your life to make you... I'm not talking in particular about anybody or anything. But anyway, you'd rather be around optimists, right? Any day. Because as Christians, we're optimists because we know, no matter what, that God's at work. Okay? And let me say this. God's at work even if you don't know He's at work. Even if you can't, let's say, feel it, like some people might say. Just don't feel like God's at work. You know what I say to that person? Doesn't matter. God's not dependent on your feeling like He's at work to be at work in your life. Thank God for that, right? So even when we're not optimistic, when we're pessimistic, God's at work. You know, I think we worry about a lot of things in this life. No doubt about it. And Paul's the one who said not to be anxious about anything, right? So, that's hard. I wish I could do it. I wish I could tell you that there became a point in my life where I never worried again. I worry about my children. I worry about my grandchildren. I worry about my wife. You know, I worry about a lot of things. You know, there's things I don't worry about that are good that I don't worry about. But I do worry, and I know we all worry. But in Christ, we already have the victory. It's already done, and that's the hard part to kind of wrap our mind around. Whatever we're worrying about, whatever we're anxious about, God has already acted on it. And he sees it clearly, and he knows it. It's like I sat down with Kim's mom a couple weeks ago and explained to her the reality is we prayed for her to be healed, and God did it. She's healed. You know when he did it? The day she became a Christian. He healed her and made her perfect and gave her a perfect body in eternity. She just hadn't seen it yet. She just hasn't realized it yet. But I'm not worried about it. And she shouldn't either. And we shouldn't either. No matter what you're going through today, whatever difficulty you have, whatever worry you have, whatever problem you have, you've prayed about it and God has answered it. I promise you, God has already answered it. We just may not have realized it yet. You know, the victory has already been determined. And no matter how bad the circumstances get for us, Paul says, I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering in verse 13. So no matter how bad the circumstances get for us, I promise you this, you're only going to fall so far. God's only going to let you fall so far. God only lets us fall so far because, and I know this because Paul said it in Romans 8, 35 through 39, that nothing happens, not a single thing happens for those who are in Christ. It's not for good. Okay? For those who have trusted in him and obey him. So, Christians, what's the worst thing that can happen to you? What's the worst thing that can happen to you right now, today? The worst thing that could happen to you in this room today is that you could die. That's the worst thing that could happen to you. You could die. You could walk out of here and get killed in a car wreck. You could have a heart attack. Whatever it is, that's the worst thing that could happen to you. But all that means is God's there. God's there when we die. So in the worst of things, God is there. And, you know, Christians really own death. You ever said that about something that you've achieved? I owned it. I own that. We own death. We own death. It's part of our belonging to God. Look at 1 Corinthians 3, 22 and 23. It'll say it to you. You know, this is where those external things that begin to happen in our lives cause us stress and take away our joy. This is where we can begin to deal with those things. So, if in everything that comes your way, you were able to say, what's the worst thing that could happen to me? And it could always be, I could die. I mean, even if you're 13 years old, you're not thinking about those kind of things. But you say, I have to go to school. What's the worst thing that could happen to me in school? And I'm kind of talking in a reality, aren't I? The worst thing that could happen to me in school is I could die. Like in Parkland. But if our children understand who they are in Christ, they can own that. Because the worst thing that can happen to anyone is they can die, and that's an immediate presence with Jesus in Christ. Okay? So as we begin to own that, what we begin to own these other things that cause us to be depressed, that cause us to be down. You know, whatever happens, wherever we are, Jesus is there. No matter what happens, wherever we are, Jesus is there. That is just so simple. That is so simple. Even a three-month-old could understand it. Did I guess kind of right? Yeah. And so that's part of God, part of Paul's enjoying God's grace. That's how he enjoyed the grace so much. That's who we are. That's who we are. So you say, those are just some big preacher words. Those are, or you could ask, are those just big preacher words that preachers throw out? What do we do then? Even though you're saying that, what do we do when discouragement comes? Well, mostly we cry. Mostly we weep. And protest to God. Right? Have you been doing that any in your life? Crying? Weeping? Telling God why this shouldn't be happening to you? Those are all legitimate responses. So don't think you, I don't know whether I should do it. Those are all legitimate responses. When you get discouraged, I would suggest you cry. I suggest you weep. And I suggest you cry out to God. Why is this happening to me? Because you know where I see that? All the prophets did it. All the psalmists did it over and over in the Bible. They're hollering out to God. Why? Why is this happening to me? Why is this happening to your people, God? Why do you let these things happen? But I'll say too, you notice they did it with kind of a reverence and a humility when they went before God, by which crying and weeping. If you look in the Bible, that can be a good Bible study for you. Look at where people cry and weep to God. And you know what it always turns into? Trust or belief. Always. When somebody cries or weeps, it turns into trust or belief. So don't let any preacher tell you, what are you doing crying, Christian? What are you doing weeping, Christian? What are you doing complaining to God? You must have, no, because what God is going to do with that crying and weeping and he's going to turn that into a stronger trust or faith in him. He uses it. And so the key to discouragement is what? Always turn to God. Always turn to God. When you're crying, when you're weeping, when you're in pain, turn to God. That's what Paul did. Turn to God. Always turn to God. The biggest threat to discouragement in our life comes to us. It came to these readers in Ephesians. And I think it comes to the modern people in the church when they don't turn to God. When they try to take these things and take care of them themselves. It is possible to be what Ephesians is describing. And Paul would say that it's always true. He would say, so live this out. Let me just share with you quickly three ways we do it wrong. Three ways we kind of go about this wrongly. They're quick. Three errors to avoid in seeking to apply this boldness. And if I haven't let that land on you, what I'm wanting you to be is bold before God in this access, and so you feel confident. Do you go boldly to God? Boldly to God. I'll give you an example, then I'll get off of it. And I don't want to, people mourn and people hurt in different ways, but there's this student from Parkland that they keep showing on the news. And every time they interview him, he's screaming things. He's screaming things at the president. He even, and then he's hurt, I know he's hurt, but when they found out that one of the police officers, or now I think a couple of police officers, didn't go in during the shooting. I don't know if you've heard that. Well, they interviewed him, and he made this bold statement that's the problem in America, is that our policemen are running away from the shooters, and our kids are left to take the bullets. No. We got a lot of policemen going straight in to the fire. We got a lot of people taking bullets for our children, but I know he's hurting. So, but that's an example I'm trying to give of how you can be bold in these statements and it be the wrong approach. Boldness in our approach to God should not be mistaken for some kind of presumption before God. Okay? Boldness and reverence, okay? Even a proper fear of God go hand in hand. And I think we all demonstrate that when we think of going before God. We're not going to go to God screaming and hollering. We're not going to run up to God when he comes for us and scream and holler at him like this poor kid. There's going to be a fear and a reverence. But God says, I want you to come to me boldly. But there's a reverence and there's a proper fear. What we have is a boldness and a belonging and an access to God. It's like a freedom. Do you have people in your life you don't feel like you're accessible to? You know, an authority maybe or something. Maybe somebody in a job can identify. Maybe in the military situation you can kind of identify that with. Any of you, especially who served in active service, and did you feel like, hey, I know where the general is. I'm just going to go talk to him about this situation. Just barge right in. No. But it's kind of funny because God is the creator of everything, and he wants us to boldly come to him. But there's a reverence and there's a humility that comes with that. It's not this overconfidence we have in knowing that we can speak directly to God. That's an improper way to go, is to go boldly but without humility. Second, confidence is not arrogance. It should not communicate to others any thought of superiority. Just because we can go before God and we have confidence in that, it's not something that we demonstrate to other people as something that makes us superior to them, right? And that can be kind of a wrong approach to going boldly before God. The last one is the one I see most commonly, though. Confidence in God and his action and his ability to take care of everything in our life should not be considered a path to being inactive, right? As though there's nothing in it for us to do, okay? God, I'm going to give you this problem I have. Take care of it. I'm not going to do anything. I've given it to you. I don't have to worry about it anymore. I think we kind of take the be still and know that I am God too far sometimes. It's like, you know, an extreme example or misunderstanding would be when people are in danger and trouble, right? And they do nothing and they die because they expected God to do something. Okay? And we always have those extreme examples. And every once in a while, one will come across or come out in the news. That if I just trust in God, no matter what it is, I don't have to do anything and he's going to take care of me. No, that's not the way the relationship works. That's not confidence. That's just a lack of wisdom. God didn't give us these incredible minds and abilities to do nothing with them. Okay? So it doesn't render us inactive because we've given it to God. Let me just leave it at that. So kind of here's the thing. Here's the thing when it comes to, I've gone back and forth. Christian living is kind of like a paradox. And a paradox is something that's true, though it doesn't make sense. Okay? Something that's true, but that everything we do and try is a reason why doesn't make sense. Okay? It seems senseless. It seems contradictory. So I know we raise our children telling them the only thing you can have faith in is that those things that you do. Take care of yourself. Nobody's going to take care of you. Only trust in those things you can do for yourself. And then we say, but I want you to believe in Jesus, whom you can't see or touch or feel or hear audibly, but I need you to believe in him by faith. It's something you can't see, but I need you to believe in him, right? That's kind of a paradox for them then. Mom, Dad, how can I believe in something that I can't see or touch or feel or hear? How can I do that? That makes no sense. So Christian living is kind of that way. And when it comes to suffering and death and evil, there's the paradox. Paul was a prisoner, right? In prison, right? But he said, I'm seated with Jesus in the heavens. He was a prisoner, but he was seated with Jesus. That's a paradox. Doesn't make sense to anybody reading this. Doesn't make sense. He thought he was among the least. He said he was the least among the least, right? How low is that? He was the least among the least, but he was a recipient of the direct revelation of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ spoke to him, but he still thought himself, that's a paradox. Doesn't make sense. You've got revelation from God. How can I be the least of the least? You know, Paul, here's the good one, because he links this in verse 13. Paul found glory in suffering. He found glory in suffering and knew both the not now. He knew both the now but not yet. That doesn't make sense. That doesn't make sense in the world. He emphasized the new creation and the eternal purpose of God who created all things. Okay? He knew what it meant to lose one's life in order to find it. Well, that doesn't make sense. That doesn't make sense. When we tell people sometimes you have to give up everything to find or to receive what God wants for you, that doesn't make sense. It's a paradox. And so here's the thing. There's a lot of tension in this Christian life. A lot of tension. A lot of tension. And it's a life of tension. And it's a life of creative, peaceful tension in a lot of ways. And that's a paradox. It doesn't make sense by the worldly standard. And it's a life of balance, but also a life of death. Death. And that doesn't make sense. Ephesians 3, 1 through 13 is a passage that is very rich, very deep, and it's not going to allow simplistic answers. It's really not. That's why it took four sermons to talk about it. It just doesn't allow simplistic answers to our faith. And you know that simplistic answers frustrate me. Some people love simplistic answers. Just give it to me straight, short, and sweet. And I'm not saying the gospel is hard. It's simple. But to live in Christ, like Paul is talking about, to live in unity in this chapter, to live in unity, to live out a grace that serves others, to value the treasure that God has given us in His Son Christ, and now to have confidence in Christ is a complex point for a Christian. And this text has some very complex points. But what it's speaking to is the fullness that is found in Jesus. Texts like this really kind of push me, and I think they push all of us beyond simplistic answers. I think a lot of times simplistic answers are kind of circulated in the name of Jesus, in the name of Christ. But I think more and more our world is becoming more and more complicated. Any of you seniors think the world has gotten a little more complicated? And for our children and our grandchildren, it's getting real complicated. And they don't need simplistic answers. Our children and our grandchildren need us to dig hard into the gospel. To demonstrate to them this incredible grace that's being offered in Christ. This incredible confidence that is available in Jesus Christ. The unity. Again, I won't go back, and it's time for us to go and preach last week, but I'm telling you, I'll say this one more time, maybe to get you to go watch it. If we could start living out the unity in the church that Paul is asking us to demonstrate, we can change this country. We can. Anyway, what this text does it calls us to risk our life. Okay? There's a call here to risk our life in the depth of grace. It could be as simple as this illustration. Some of you stood by a body of water that you were afraid to jump into. You didn't know how deep it was, or you thought it was too deep for you to stand up anyway. You were afraid. Some of you still are. Norma doesn't like to swim, I know. Norma doesn't like to get into deep water, I know. And grace can be like that sometimes. It can seem kind of overwhelming, right? But what Paul's saying is, I want you to dive in. I want you to dive into this grace and trust that Jesus has you. So if I could just end it today, I'd say go for it. Just dive in to God's grace. Let me pray. Father, thank you so much for this time and this message from Paul. And I pray that for everyone here. I know that we all come here with different